All right, we have a couple of weeks worth of questions from Sunday mornings. First of all is, how do you rechannel anger or temper with sin? And how do you suggest you deal with maybe bitterness about things in your past, being angry with God himself? And there's several things there. First of all is that anger is rooted a lot of times in pride. We feel like we should be treated a certain way. We feel like we should experience certain privileges in life. And some of the aspects of anger is a wrong view of self, a higher view of self than we ought to have, or maybe a lower view of other people than we should have, whatever the case may be. And so selfishness comes from that. And anger is sometimes radiates out of that. And so I would say the first thing is to deal with it by realizing that pride may be the heart of this, that the reason I'm mad at my brother or my nephew or cousin or next door neighbor or church member is that I'm proud about who I think I should be and how I should be treated. And in that moment, anger may emerge. Now, bitterness towards God is a little different. You have a bad experience in life, you lose a child, you lose a spouse, and the temptation is to blame God. And one of the struggles with that is that we fail sometimes to see the substantial grace of God for eternal life and the fact that that individual will be with us in heaven, most likely, if they're a believer, they would be with us in heaven. And, you know, you lose a child or you lose a parent, that you'll see them again, that this life is not the end of the story, and that this life compared to eternity is like a thimble of water compared to the ocean. And so with that, we also have to have eternal perspective. And this is where we say God uses suffering in a lot of different ways. One way he uses it is to develop character in us, James 1, Romans chapter 5. Another way that God uses suffering is he allows us to go through suffering so that we're able to comfort other people who go through similar trials, so that we become a support to other people having walked through those valleys. It's always easier to feel the support of an individual who survived cancer when you're going through cancer. They just feel a connection with them. And so a lot of times that's the case. That's why there's support groups a lot of times that emerge with people who have lost a child, people who have lost a spouse, and there's a support there from people who share common experience. Number three is that sometimes God uses suffering to get our spiritual attention, to be focused, more prayerful. When people go through trials and troubles, a lot of times they are more spiritually inclined. And so there's a lot of reasons why troubles occur. And I would suggest we don't spend a lot of time trying to figure it out, like, oh, why did God do this? Is it because there's this issue or that issue? But instead to just say, okay, I'm going to trust God through the midst of this. I'm going to see what he has to teach me through this. I'm going to let him hone my character through this. I'm going to let him use me for ministry through this. And I'm going to be humble and gracious. And then I'm going to let the fact that this life is incredibly short, and it's like being upset over a thimble full of water being spilled on the carpet when there's an entire ocean of it waiting to be experienced. And so, whoops, we lost the thimble of water. I poured out here in kind of an inconvenient way. Well, yeah, but there's an ocean of water waiting on us. Don't worry about that. So keeping our perspective on eternity, I think, helps as well. It's not easy to do. This is the life we see, and this is the moment we're experiencing. But eternity helps us. God will set all things right in the end. No injustice will remain. No tears will remain. And those who have walked faithfully through suffering will actually receive a greater reward. And so I would think eternal perspective helps with that. Number two, I have a coworker who is a Christian, stronger than many, but is also a lesbian and married to her partner or companion of 6 years. I told her my position, that it's sin. She said she has made her peace with God. Any words on that situation? Well, the short answer is that apart from a covenant relationship with inside the church, really our obligation as believers to believers and unbelievers outside the church is a little different. If someone asks me my opinion about it, I will tell them, hey, I think there's some concerns that Scripture identifies those things that are outside God's will for us. But my primary concern for someone outside the church is that they know the gospel. And so I don't know that I would make a huge deal about that with them. I would make a huge deal about the gospel with other people. Those within the community of the church, within the covenant, we would say, okay, now wait. We have, as a covenant community with one another, a standard of moral behavior that we hold as a congregation. And I'd be very cautious there. So people outside the church, I would be heavy emphasis on the gospel. If they claim to be believers and they ask you point blank about it, I would tell them, yeah, you know, I understand where you're coming from, but from my perspective, those things seem to be outside God's standard for morality. However, I'm not a fellow church members of yours. We're not in the same covenant of faith, and I think it would be inconsistent with our covenant faith and understanding of the scripture. However, I'm not your judge, and I'm not God for you. I would just say, I would point you back to the scripture and say, you know, we're all obligated to study the scripture and apply it, and we're all accountable to God and how we do that. With that, the biggest issue in your life is not, or mine, is not that. The biggest issue in our life is who Jesus Christ is and what our eternal destiny is. And that's what I would try to redirect all conversations there, because God redirects all conversations there. The Bible spends a lot more emphasis on Jesus Christ and who he is as the Son of God and our eternity than he does on specific moral issues. That said, I think if someone really is humble before God and knows him, that conviction of sin will come, and sometimes it comes slowly, sometimes quickly, but God will move us as believers if we're humble before him to the place we need to be. In that, I would also say, guard our hearts against pride. We see someone else caught in a particular area of sin and we go, wow, that's wrong and I would never do that. We got to make sure that in the process of that, I'm prone sometimes to then feel prideful and say, well, I've never been trapped in this or that issue. You know, I've never used illicit drugs or something like that. Well, okay, but I've got my own list of issues. And so we want to also be humble about that. And I'm sure the person who wrote this, as humble as they wrote the question, is probably working through that anyway. Like, how do I help this person while also, you know, acknowledging the fact that they seem, the person they're talking to seems to be a very devout believer. And so that's a very humble response. And I would just say on that, your obligation to the covenant community of church is a little different to those outside. And I would stick with the gospel. And if they ask you point blank about moral questions, you can say, hey, that's not how I understand scripture. We're all obligated to conform our lives to what God says, but you're not within the covenant community, and I'm not your judge. And so with that, we just humbly serve Christ together and walk with him as best we can. That's what I would probably respond to that person as such. Also, the last thing, such were some of you, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, mean a person who was a homosexual, becomes a Christian, is no longer a homosexual. Let me just say this. When Paul talks about that, what he means is primarily in the act of practice, not the issue of being inclined towards a particular act. And so I would just say that when Paul talks about those who struggle with, say, alcohol, he's not talking about an individual who is an alcoholic who says, you know what, I can't be around this stuff because if I am, I'll be inclined to slide back into that. Paul would say in that, not that they're no longer an alcoholic the way we talk about it, but that's really a very 20th, 21st century language of sociology to say that individuals who struggle with certain areas are prone toward it still. So we would say of a homosexual that if they're not practicing the act, Paul would say they're not a homosexual, at least in practice, and so that's how he would view it. We would say they may still have a tendency towards that, but not practicing it is the real issue. So our inclination toward alcoholism or anger or illicit drugs or sexuality or pride doesn't mean that we're no longer prone towards those things. It just means that we're not practicing them, and that's primarily how Paul sees them. And so I do think if someone comes out of a homosexual lifestyle, this doesn't mean that they don't have that inclination toward it. It is a battle, and we ought to be very gracious. Someone who has the courage to try to fight through that, we ought to support them. Those who would say, I'm just going to live in that lifestyle, we'd say, boy, that don't think that's what God intends for you. However, you've been made in the image of God, and God has great love for you, and you're of infinite worth. And so we should be careful to not castigate people harshly, too, because that doesn't accomplish anything either other than to make them dehumanized. And that's one thing I think that has been identified lately within the culture at large, and really should have been already within the church's heart, is because someone's caught in a particular aspect of sin, now is the time not to dehumanize that person so as to destroy them. Now is the time to be gentle and gracious, but hold to a standard of righteousness while also holding to the gospel and just say, I love you. I don't think this is best for you, but I'm also not going to beat you with the Bible every time I see you. And so gentle, fair, gracious treatment of all people, regardless of the sin, is necessary. And if someone who comes out of a lifestyle like alcoholism is tempted and falls back into it, again, we want to gently confront them. If they go, I know I need help, we want to help them. If they fall back into it again, we help them again. And so what we want to do is be gracious and encouraging while holding a standard of righteousness. So we don't want to excuse sin. We also don't want to beat people with the Bible over it, because we don't want someone to do that to us. If I get trapped in some area of sin, I don't want the whole church coming around going, well, let's beat him with a bat. No, I want the church to say, how can we help you? If a person's unrepentant, that's a different issue. And there the church has to kind of say, no, look, this really is our standard as a congregation. So with that, I would say homosexuals, along with drunkards, are those who are sexually involved outside of marriage, or those who are prideful, or those who are envious or jealous or greedy, or whatever the sin might be that traps various people within the congregation, that we were saved out of that. That's not who we are now, but we still may be prone to fall back into those lifestyles because of sin nature. And so someone who was a homosexual may still be prone towards that sin. If they fall back in that sin, they're in Christ, so they are a believer primarily in their identity who struggles with an old lifestyle. And so I'd be careful about how, I agree with the question in that, I would be careful about just saying, well, you were saved, so you should never struggle with that again. I would say that in Christ, they're no longer identified by what they did. They're now identified by what he did. That doesn't mean they don't have that struggle anymore, though. Good question. Those are tough things, and we want to be gracious while holding a standard of righteousness. We'll see you guys on Sunday morning. God bless you. Have a good week.